Hi, this is Jose Luis, and welcome to a new video in this series, Introduction to Parametric Modeling. In these videos, in this new section that I would like to start with this video, I would like to talk specifically about the concept of data. And sorry for the really bad sketch. It's been a while since I've drawn things on anywhere. But I would like to start a new section where I'm going to delve a little deeper into topics related to data, because data generation, data manipulation, and data handling are perhaps one of the most important topics when it comes to algorithmic modeling. But at the same time, for us beginners, it might be one of the topics that takes a little more time to wrap our heads around, because it's one of the newer topics that that we have to deal with if we are new to modeling in 3D using algorithms. It turns out that this might be one of the trickiest topics, but at the same time, if we get a good grasp on how data works and how we can use it to our advantage, it's also one of the most powerful tools that we can have in our tool set for computational design. So that's why I would like to take special time and consideration in the videos that I'm going to record on this topic, in this section, okay? So in this section, I'm going to teach you how to think about data, conceptualize it, how to see it flowing through our algorithms, and at the same time, I'm going to teach you in particular how data is handled in Grasshopper and what data structures are available there and how we can use them to our advantage. And before we go into explaining any of that, what I would like to do is I would like to explain an example, show an example of the typical problems that we're going to run if we don't handle data well. Because trust me on this one, 90% of the problems that you're going to have when you start working at a deeper level with tools such as Grasshopper are going to be related to data and data manipulation and data structures. So let's take a look first at an example of a data problem that we may very easily encounter. If you remember from one of my previous videos, we did an exercise that was modeling a hanging cloth. And the idea behind this exercise was just taking two input curves and then creating catenary curves between them so that we could mimic somehow this idea of a piece of fabric sagging and then its own weight. So I would like to propose that we try a very, very similar approach, but instead of using the catenary logic, the idea that the fabric deforms under its own weight, I'm going to try a new method. I'm going to propose to you that you give a try to doing the following exercise. We're going to model something very, very similar. We're going to also model that some kind of canopy that starts from two input curves that we may have in Rhino, for example. And then what we're going to do is we're going to follow a very similar process where we're going to subdivide each one of those two curves into a bunch of points. But now, instead of joining those points with catenary curves, what we're going to do is we're going to join them with NURBS curves. And for that, we're going to need at least a third point to make the nice curvature of the canopy. That third point, we might be able to generate it with a simple method, such as, for example, drawing lines between the two points in each one of the ends of the curve, then finding some point that lies in the middle of that line, and then taking that point and moving it a control C distance. So whatever it was, we can just move it a little bit up. And we know that moving points is basically doing like some numerical computation with their coordinates. And after that, what we can do is we can join those curves. We can create new curves by joining the first point, the other point that we elevated, and the first point of the other curve. Do that successively, and then loft a surface over those curves, and then get a nice surface, all right? It's a very similar approach. It doesn't use the physics logic. It uses some other modeling logic. It will give us like a canopy that has a constant height, and it could be super interesting. So what I would like to do is I would like you, the viewer, to invite you to try this out on your own with what you have learned so far. I'm going to give you some virtual time, so you're welcome to pause this video and give this a try. tuk 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 tuk. That was time passing, in case you didn't get it. All right, hopefully you paused the video and you gave it a try at some point while I was goofing around. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to try it myself. So I'm going to go back to Grasshopper and start this exercise. And if you actually run into a problem when you were doing this exercise, that is very normal. And that's the problem that I want to run into. And that's going to be my segue into explaining data structures. Okay, let's take a look at how to do that in Grasshopper. Let's get started. I'm going to try to do the process myself and see if I run into any problems, right? So I'm going to create two curves here in Rhino, and then one is going to be like this and the other one is going to be like that. And then I'm going to bring those two curves into Grasshopper. And we've already seen how to do this in previous videos. So I'm going to copy paste this one, and then I'm going to right click and set the other curve. All right. And now I have both curves here inside of Grasshopper as input data. The next thing that I'm going to do is I'm going to subdivide them into equal length points with the divide curve component. And I'm going to do one for this curve. I'm going to do another one for this other curve. And I'm also going to drop here a slider that I'm going to use to control how many points do I have on each end. Okay. Now, the next thing that I would like to do, I'm going to double click here and say 15, for example. Whoa, that was a lot. 15. Now, the next thing that I would like to do as per our sketch is that I would like to now draw lines between the two curves and then find some point that lies in the middle or at the control distance. All right. So I'm going to now draw lines between the two. So I'm going to go to curves, primitives, line, and I'm going to draw lines between the family of points on the left and the family of points on the other end. And then now what I would like to do is I would like to find a point along those lines. We haven't seen that in any of the previous exercises, but if we go, for example, to analysis, you can see that there are a lot of different components that give us different ways of interacting or of getting data from a curve. One of them, a very common one, is point on curve, which says evaluates a curve at a specific location. So, and here, if I give it a curve, you can see that it gives me a point that is at the parameter 0, that is going to be the beginning for a line, and parameter 1, which is going to be the end for a line. Remember the video where we talked about curves having a domain that is typically starts at 0, although not always, and ends at whatever number. And we can use the parameter to find a point along that domain space. We could use this one, but I don't really like this component because it's kind of like halfway through a component in a slider. And I actually like to have all my sliders at the very beginning, and it's kind of like cumbersome if I bring this here, and it's also like I can't really change it from 0. It has to be always from 0 to 1, right? So I don't really like that. So I'd rather use this other one that is called evaluate curve. I like this component a little better because it takes in a curve, it takes in the parameter on the domain of that curve, so where along the curve I am, and then it gives me a lot of stuff afterwards. It gives me the point on the curve, it gives me the tangent vector, and it gives me the angle of the incoming versus the outcoming curve. All right. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to place that here, and I'm going to drop here a slider. I'm going to type 1.000 to get a slider from 0 to 1 with 3 decimals, and I'm going to plug that in here. And you can see that now by moving this slider, I can find a point at a relative length from 0 to 1 for lines. Because remember, straight line segments are the exception of the curves. And we know that straight line segments always have a domain that goes from 0 to 1. All right, and I have my parameter here and all my inputs. You know how I like having my inputs at the very beginning? Let's make sure that I group them properly here, and that keeps my OCD very happy. And now what I would like to do is I would like to say, well, I would like to elevate all these points a particular distance z. So I'm going to create another parameter that is another slider that is going to be the height. That's going to be, for example, 10.000. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to take all these points. I'm going to deconstruct them so that I can find their x and y locations. And then to the z location, to the z coordinate, I'm going to add the height that I just created. So I'm going to drop here an addition component. I'm going to the z height of those points. I'm going to add the height that I just created. And then I'm going to reconstruct a whole new family of points with the same x, the same y, but the new z with the increased height. Can you see that? And then I can control how high or how low those points is. I'm doing that as increments because if I were to change this curve, for example, and move the point a little higher, you would see that the points here are not planar anymore, are not on the same plane. So I would like that to be mimicked here on the top. All right, so I think we're ready, right? So let's take a look at this first. So now the only thing that we have to do left as per our sketch is to take those points, the points on the left curve, the points on the top of the canopy, and the points on the right end, and join them with an interpolated curve, for example. So where are those points? So those points are going to be here. These are the points on the left-hand side. These are the points that I just created on top. And just for the sake of clarity, I'm going to disable everything else. And I'm just going to keep the three families of points. So that's how the points on the left, the points on the middle, and the points on the right. And just to make it a little clearer, I'm just going to pass them through empty point boxes, all right? And just to have them a bit clearer. So first family, second family, and third family of points, all right? So I have the three families of points here. And now what I would like to do, and just to make sure, I'm going to put a panel and take a look at what's going on. Here I have a list of points, all of them with zero coordinates. Here I have a list of points, all of them with a very large y, z coordinate. And all of these are the points on the right. All right, so then at this point, creating these curves, the blue curves, should be just as easy as going to the curve, going to splines, and then, for example, choosing interpolate to create an interpolated curve through that set of points. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to say, well, I want to create a curve between the first family of points. I'm going to plug that in. Then between the second family of points, the one on top. So I'm going to drag this by pressing shift to add to the component. And then, something is not working well. And then I'm going to add the third family of points, pressing shift so that I add them to the list. Oh, and this is not what I expected. You see what's going on here? Let me highlight this. You see the green curve? The green curve is as opposed to what we wanted, which was several curves, each one of joining the first point, the second point. Instead of that, what we ended up with is with one single spline that went through all the first points, then all the points in the middle, and then all the points on the right-hand side. And we can also see that by putting a panel here and seeing that the output is just one single curve. So what happened here? Why is the component behaving this way and not the way that I expected, which is individual curves joining this point, this point, this point, this point, this point? Long story short, we have data problems, okay? And as I was saying before in my introduction, 90% of the problems that you're probably going to run into when working with Grasshopper, for example, and when getting results that don't match your expectations are very, very likely going to be caused by some kind of misconception or some kind of problem about how data has not been handled correctly. Okay? So, all right, so then what is the problem that is going on and how do we solve that problem? Before we get into that, I would actually like to take a break and move on to the next video where I would like first to define some concepts that relate to data and specifically data structures inside of Grasshopper. I would like to lay down some foundations and some concepts, and then once we have those clear, then we can come back to this video and to this exercise and see how we could fix our problem and and then get the desired result that we wanted. Okay, so let's put a pause here, let's put a pin on this one, and let's go into the next video where I'm going to explain data structures in Grasshopper, what they are, how they work, what are their main elements, and then what kind of operations can we perform with those. And then we will be able to come back and fix this problem. See you on the next video. And if you like what you're seeing so far, maybe consider liking this video, subscribing to the channel, turning on notifications, etc., etc. It helps us keep the ball moving. Okay? See you on the next video, and let's talk about data structures.